Today, we're going to talk about the golden altar of incense. Very quickly, I'll recap of what it was like. How many altars are there in the temple or the tabernacle? Somebody?
Two.
Two, right. Who said that?
Two.
Who said that first? Okay. Appreciate you, Sister Sharon. And all others are thinking, how many altars? Two altars. And the second question, what is the name of the exterior altar? It's there already. Come on, quickly. We don't have time. We are teaching the Bible. That's all. That's why we are doing. The name of the exterior altar.
Altar of burnt offerings.
Yes, altar of sacrifice, altar of burnt offerings, the bronze altar. You can say that also. And what is the Hebrew name for that altar?
Mishbech.
Yes, Mishbech. Mishbech is the Hebrew name for altar. Then, what does the exterior altar show? The altar of sacrifice. Quickly, somebody, if you have your notes. Otherwise, I will not continue this class, because if you do not know that, you cannot know this. Quickly.
Sacrificing ourselves.
Yes. Sacrificing
ourselves.
Sacrificing. We have a sacrifice of us. When we bring a sacrifice of us, one of the explanations, that's what exterior altar shows. Prayer is, last slide I told you, what is prayer from the altar of sacrifice? Prayer is dash to God. Fill in the blanks.
Prayer
is drawing near to God, okay? Drawing near to God. Because from the altar of sacrifice, it means we are coming near to God. We are drawing closer to God. We are drawing closer to His ways. The altar of sacrifice also shows how we elevate our external life in sacrifice to God. For example, it means, simple thing, you have a meal. You have food. How does that bring glory to God? One way is, when you have food, you talk about the things of God's word. So that food becomes, you elevate, that's the burnt offerings talk about. You elevate that to the purpose of God. That food becomes purposeful. Many of us just go hidingly, sneakingly and eat, right? Well, that all, are not, in my view, it does not elevate food to the purposes of God. To elevate food to the purposes of God, while you come in the table today, after the service, you go to the table and you just think what pastor taught you. You ask one another and you encourage one another. These days, families do not, we all eat at different times. In our house here, we have four generations living. My grandfather, they're old, so they have their own set times of eating. And then if we start eating at their times, that's all God. My parents are in the mid, so they eat sometime, and then we eat at the hour. So it's altogether different. And then Tia Timu, four generations, so they have their times. But all of us coming together and eating and talking about God's ways and works is what which elevates food. How do you elevate your work life in context of the service to God? Can you tell me? Somebody quickly. How can you elevate your work as a service to God? How can you elevate your work? Your work life. You go, you work, and you work it for God. You work not for a salary, you work for God in your workplaces. It's a Jewish concept. It is a Jewish concept. So when a Jewish person talks about the mizbeach, outer sacrifice as a prayer, what it tells is, I want to elevate my work in service to God. We pray that our work will bring glory to God. We bring our work life. What happens in a weekly basis is we look at our work life. How did we touch our work life for the better? How did we elevate God in our work life? We are not serving God to elevate our work life, but we work to elevate God, to elevate, to come to His purpose. To all of those workforces in Shelter House, my question is, you are not working for salary, you are working so that you, all your work, you will bring it to the altar of God and elevate God in that manner. In my view, each of you who are working in your workplace is not just working for your salary, but God has a purpose for that. Last week, couple of weeks, I was talking to Brother Joel, Jenila's husband, and he was telling how God brought them to that community where he's staying there. And there was a brethren couple, brethren guy. They don't believe in the Holy Spirit, but they are talking together. What has happened? Big miracles are happening. Well, we'll all say that together later. But the thing is, wherever you're staying, God has a purpose for that. And the exterior altar says, I bring my work life in service to you. I bring my family life in service to you. I bring my educational life in service to you. But what we do mostly is, citing that, we excuse from prayer. No. If you say your work as an excuse for prayer, you know who is behind it. But if you say, I come with my work to you, Lord. I come with my work to you. Take my work and use it for your glory. Use my wealth for your glory. Use my intellect for your glory. Then there will be a big blessing. So altar sacrifice shows how we elevate our external life. Even food, eating food. Those times we should thank God, think about God. And that's how you elevate your food. How you elevate your education. You bring that and say, Lord, use my studies for your glory. So Tia and Gail and Leah and John and Joshua and Sakshi and Sean and Johan and all of us, what should we do? We should elevate our education to its purpose. I left many children because of the time lag. Okay, right. So the bronze altar is what we talked about last week. If you missed it last week, well, it will term Greek and Latin for you, but you can go to YouTube and probably watch it. But this is the first level of getting to God. So prayer, having understood this, I have thought many of us have not even stepped into that first realm of drawing near. Drawing near to God is drawing near with your occupation. Drawing near so that your occupation will fulfill God's purpose in your life. That's prayer. Prayer is bringing your occupation. Prayer is bringing your community. Prayer is bringing your family. Prayer is bringing whatever God has blessed you with to divine purposes. Exterior things of life. How is your exterior thing? Is your work life messed up? Bring it to the altar. Is your family life messed up? Bring it to the altar. Is your educational life messed up, screwed up? Bring it to the altar. All of us, let's come to the altar. Hallelujah. Amen. So that's first altar is external. There are two. Prayer involves both your altars. One is the external altar and your internal life. What is the difference between the golden altar and the external altar was made of bronze. And this was the highest, this golden altar was the highest furniture in the whole tabernacle or the temple. It was high. The height was its height was big. It was the highest furniture. And as you saw, the priest would come with incense. Incense is a mixture of herbs, which there are four herbs which are said in the Bible. But then extra seven are there. That's what the Jewish people believe. So around 11 things, they mix it together. They take the coal from the outer altar and bring both into that golden altar, and they burn it. And then the smoke goes from there morning and evening. So that's the duty of the priest, morning and evening, the sweet incense. Usually the altar, the temple is having all these sacrifices filled with blood and foul smell. But inside the holy place, what's happening is sweet aroma, and that is a perpetual incense to the Lord. So we read about it in Exodus 30, 1 to 7. So just note it down, Exodus 30, 1 to 7. That's what we read it. That's what that person who was narrating that golden altar was mentioning. So there are 11 herbal spices used in the incense. That's what they believe. And four of them are written in the Bible, and then it's another seven more. And one of the spices, the coal, is taken from the altar of sacrifice. Many a time we draw closer to God with the external, God looks at your external life. Otherwise, you cannot come to this inner life of prayer. External prayer is different from the inner prayer. So when you have this inner prayer life, you don't need, in my view, pastors to always tell you, come for prayer, come for prayer, come for prayer. Your mind is for prayer. You know that's the incense that is so important to God. Out of all that is happening around, out of all the mess that is happening, you know that your internal life with God is most important. So that can only happen from the outer sacrifice. Outer sacrifice is using your work, using your life as a sacrifice to God. Then only you can, we pray for many things, bless this, bless that, bless those things. In my view, well, thank God for the Holy Spirit. That's why I said that our greatest weakness is we do not know how we ought to pray. Romans 8:26, and yet we pray. How we pray? What is the prayer that the Lord expects us to do? And that starts, I would say, from the outer courts, where we bring it all, where we bring our work, where we bring our food, when we bring our energy and say, oh God, we bring it to you. Oh God, we bring it to you. Now let it burn. Let it all burn in service to you. Let my work be a service to you. Let my work life be a service to you. Let my physical life be a service to you. Let my food be of service to you. Only when we cross that mark can we go into the second life. Have you given your occupation to the Lord? You're a software engineer. You're a team lead, or you're a nurse. Have you given it for the purposes of God? That's what the first level of altar, which we talked last week. And unless you cross that, you cannot come into this golden altar. This is made of gold. The coal is taken from the altar of sacrifice. The incense or the ketoret has 10 kosher materials. Kosher means ceremonially clean materials, but one is non-kosher. What does that signify is there's transformation of all, we all have at least one or the other character that hides us, that prevents us from experiencing the fullness of God. But when it comes to a gathering, when we come together, when we put all what is clean around it, all our uncleanness vanishes away. That's what it shows, the incense. So those who are in Jacobite, Marthomite, probably CSI has the incense. Does the CSI have the incense, brother? Does the priest do the incense?
No, Pastor.
Okay. I think the Marthomites have it. In every service, they have that incense. Well, are they made of that particular mixture? It's not. I don't think so. Of course, the Old Testament priesthood is gone. But Old Testament priesthood brings us to understanding about what God desires from us. That's why it's there. So throughout the year, the ketoret means that incense. Okay, the Hebrew word for incense is ketoret. Ketoret was burned twice daily on the golden or inner altar that stood within the inner section of the temple, distinct from the outdoor copper altar. Copper was how Solomon laid it, upon which animal sacrifices and libations were brought. Additionally, the highlight of the Yom Kippur service, Yom Kippur is the Day of Atonement. The high priest entering the Holy of Holies with a pan of smoldering coals in one hand and a ladle filled with ketoret on the other, that's the incense, and then placing the ketoret over the coals and leaving once it was filled with fragrant smoke. So this is the only material that they take once in a year into the Holy of Holies. So this incense is very important. What does this show? That's my point. That's my point. What is the golden altar of incense show? And one thing is sure, it is different from the outer altar. This is a deeper level of our life with God. Ketoreth shows our deeper life of prayer. Incense prayer shows the deeper life of prayer which we have. Just write it down. Golden altar and incense shows the deeper life which we enjoy in the walk with the Lord. How is your depths? Is your depths clean? Are your depths to the Lord? If you look at Psalm 42, verse 7, Psalm 42, verse 7. Quickly.
It's too deep. In the roar of your waterfalls, all your waves and breakers have swept over me.
Deep calls to deep from the innermost part. That's what Ketoret is all about. That's what the incense is all about. How is your incense? How is your deeper life with God? Is it just confined to a Sunday service, or is it much more deeper than that? God is calling out as we meditate on the golden altar of incense to come first. You cannot have this life without the altar sacrifice. You have to today give your life, your service, your work life into God's hands and say, I will not give it as an excuse from not coming to you, but with it I will serve you. I will bring my work life so that I will be an influence. I will be a transformation, a person of transformation in my workplace. There are people who are discouraged, depressed. My challenge for all the managers who are working here, you have your calls, I understand that. But just before the call, 5 minutes, hey, how is your family? Is everything okay? They may have some problems. Just say, okay, I'm praying for you. Don't force them. Hey, come for prayer. No, I'm praying for you. Just that word will strike them, will touch them, then pray for them. All of them who have a team to work with. Talk about their personal life. You think, okay, I only talk about work. Like, God has called you to be there so that your incense, so that your work will be elevated in service to God. With my work, I serve God. And then you come into the deeper level of your heart. And it burns twice daily, the inner part. I would say this talks about three things. I'll come to it very soon. Okay. The first, there are with three examples, I want to show it to you. How important is the incense before the presence of the Lord? Can anyone say what is this showing? It's a new creation, so it's copyright. I got it from the net. But can anyone say what is this picture showing? Who is in the picture?
Aaron
is in the picture, and what is he doing?
So the people of Israel grumbled against them, and the Lord sent a plague among them.
Yes.
So to stop the plague, Aaron stands between the living and the dead, and he presents the incense before
the incense. Yeah, incense from the holy place. That's the incense. What does that show? What does that show? And that is there in Numbers 16 and 48. I like that verse. Underline and keep it. So Tia will read it. Numbers 16, 48. It's been a long time since Tia Terza is reading God's word, Numbers 16 and 48, and Terza will read it.
He stood between the living and
you're unmuted. Okay.
And the plague stopped, but 14,700 people died from the plague in addition to.
Okay, that's enough. He stood between the living and dead. Friend, we are facing a pandemic. All this while we are talking about God's grace and blessing and thanksgiving, thanking God for his mercies. Today also I was reading about many sad stories that is happening in the pandemic. No oxygen supplies. See, oxygen supply in cities are less because it's industrial manufactured oxygen which they put in ventilators. And they are telling that oxygen supply vans should have the ambulance siren fit, because they will have easy flow. In Maharashtra, it's already done. Bangalore, still traffic, it's fighting it hard. Who will stand between the living and the dead? It's you and your prayer life. It's you and your prayer life. Early in the morning, late in the evening or night, will you stand like Aaron doing this? He's burning a sweet incense. Something lovely to the Lord. Something beautiful to the Lord. I encourage you to do that. Sometimes it may be a one meal fasting and praying. It might be early in the morning, rising up and praying, "Oh Lord, save my land." We need to do that. Why don't we just lift our hands from wherever we are and just cry out, "Oh Lord, save our land. Save our land." Come on, talk it out. Talk it out. I stand between the living and the dead. I stand in between the living and the dead. Raise up that smoke within me, that incense, that favor. Lord, I want that. That incense talks about the transformation your life has. See, your prayer cannot work without incense. There should be a definite transformation. Transformation in your prayer life. Transformation in your Bible meditation life. Transformation in your public life. Your words, your talk. How? My question last week I asked you, how has your life changed for the better after this pandemic? Your interpersonal, do you value relationships more? Or do you value God more? Unless God's presence touches, that's the incense. He's standing with his life. Aaron is going in between the plague. In our state, he's the corona warrior. He's standing between. The thing can spread to him. He's standing between the living and the dead. And God is showing you this so that today you will catch up with that vision of God. I will stand between the living and the dead. With my life transformed, I want to make sure that this plague which is unleashed by the enemy or whatever, whoever is behind it, it should stop. It should stop. I will stand as a watchman for my city. There is nothing greater than this now. Your promotion can wait. Your increase can wait. But lives are more important. Lives are more important. Will you take a definite stand for prayer and say, "Lord, India is increasing. We cannot afford this to increase for months. We want to see it come down." As Brother Dillu was praying, Amit Shah is again in the hospital. Sonia Gandhi has gone for her treatment abroad. People are facing tough times. Many outpatient units are closed. No more dialysis patients are afraid and they are dying. No more vaccines. Small children are deprived from their vaccines. Why? We need someone to stand between the living and the dead. Will you take it on yourself? Will you take it on yourself? Will you say, "Lord, as your servant is speaking, I want to take up the incense and stand between the living and the dead"? If that's your prayer, God will give you that grace. Hallelujah. Come on, talk to the Lord. Reba Shataraba. If you want to come out of this thing unscathed, demonic forces are around this. Pharmaceutical majors and their profits are beyond. Brothers and sisters, if this pandemic has to go, there should be Aarons who will rise up with incense from the golden altar. Ruba Shadaraba Sakala Daradara. Yesterday I was seeing Reverend Franklin Graham talking about a Netflix movie which is talking about sexual exploitation about girls. It is showing them in a bad light. And he said, "Cancel Netflix subscription." He gave a wide warning to Netflix users, telling this is it shows, you know, people in a corrupt manner. Ghislaine Maxwell and Jeffrey Epstein, with many leaders of the world, abused, molested many girls, sold them as sexual slaves for favor. What we see in India, you see in Kannada movie, two main film stars, women, are arrested for drug racket. Do you think they are the only ones? There are many kingpins sitting above and they just targeted them probably. But drug use is banned in India. That's why I said, do you want your children to go in an ecstasy because of drug abuse, or do you want them to be in the presence of the Lord? You can make a choice to stand between the living and the dead. The second story which we hear is, can anyone say what is this? It's also about the incense. Yeah. This is from Revelation chapter 8 and verse 4. Can we read it together? Somebody can read it for me. Revelation chapter 8 and verse 4. Revelation 8, 4. Somebody quickly. Where are all our readers?
Together with the prayers of God's people went up before God from angel's hand.
From the angel's hand. This is in heaven. What John is seeing is another angel who had a golden censer came and stood at the altar. He was given much incense to offer with the prayers of all God's people on the golden altar in front of the throne. Friends, we are facing a tough time. During this, what is happening is FCRA of many good organizations are cut. Many missions, people are against Christian movements, very physically our India. There's persecution around. But what is happening in heaven? There is this angel, and some people say this angel is showing the Lord Jesus himself. Well, that's a different topic to discuss. We will talk about it later. But whoever, there's an angel. And he was given much incense to offer with prayers of all God's people, all God's people. And these God's people are those who are facing persecution. They're telling, oh God, how long will we suffer on the earth? And the smoke, verse 4, the smoke of the incense together with the prayers of God's people went up before God from the angel's hand. Then what did the angel do? Verse 5, then the angel took the censer, filled it with fire from the altar and hurled it on the earth. And there came peals of thunder, rumblings, flashes of lightning and an earthquake. So what John is really telling is a persecuted church, when it is praying for redemption, there will be natural calamities like this, peals of thunder. God will shake the nature. What we are seeing in Oregon probably is something of that sort. We do not know how the Lord, you know, we do not have the right to do vengeance. Vengeance belongs to the Lord. Vengeance belongs to the Lord. Vengeance belongs to the Lord. But our prayers, when we are in the tough times, our prayers with the incense, what God does is he will come to redeem the earth. But what is needed? Now, if the prayers of God's people are not there, what will happen? God's hand of work will not be, God's hand of justice will not be there. We need God's kingdom to come. We need God to change these present situations. We need God to take away people who are thinking evil, wicked things in their mind. You know, if we are not having God, we think wicked things. The wicked have no hope. But when we see the wicked rising up, we should say, oh God, save us, redeem your world. And with these prayers, the angels are giving the incense, and then natural disasters like flashes of lightning. So this talks about the seven seals and the golden seals. And after this, there's the trumpets and then the vials. In my view, these things have happened through the century. You know, something like these are figurative, apocalyptic, figurative languages. And whenever the people of God have cried, God has come to their rescue. But will you take that option to cry? Like Aaron stood between with the angel. Will the angel have the prayer from your household to offer before the Lord? Hallelujah. Amen. Can you say this, lifting your hands? My household will be in the prayer of God's people so that the angel will have something to offer with the incense in the presence of God. Hallelujah. Build your family. There's nothing greater than your prayer life. Write it down, brother. Your degrees matter, amount to nothing. Your wealth amount to nothing. There is nothing greater than your prayer life. Hallelujah. Final verse is Psalm 141 and verse 2. It's there in the slide itself. Can we just say that together? Let my prayer rise up like incense before you. So it's a deep prayer. It's talk about prayer life. Prayer with incense. Incense is praying according to God's will. Prayer according to God's word. It's united prayer. You know what you need to pray for. What does it show? Number one, it shows intimate prayer. Korban. Korban means sacrifice. Korbanot. But ketoret means cleaving to God. Say cleaving to God. Cleaving to God. It's united with God. It's being united with God. It's being united with God. Hallelujah. It's being united with God. Look at Psalm 91 and verse Psalm 91 and verse 14. If there is an NIV, KJV, it will be good. 91:14. Anybody has King James version?
Because he hath set his love upon me, therefore will I deliver him. I will set him on high because he hath known my name.
Look at that. Because he, in some translations, because he cleaves to me in love. Cleaving to God. That is the second level of prayer. You're with your inner emotions. Your husband doesn't tell, hey, come and pray. But you're cleaved to God. You're a godly woman from the innermost heart. From the inner side, you're united with God. You can hear the move of the Holy Spirit. You can hear the word of God. You're from your deep inside, you're not a surface believer. Say surface believer. Surface believer, we have had plenty of surface. We need core believers. Believers at the core. Believers at the core who have the incense, cleaving to God. Outer altar is sacrificing animal instincts, but this is sweet smelling aroma. Outer prayer is drawing near, which means korban. Inner prayer is communion, being one with the Lord. Being one. I want to tell you, friends, yeah, there's a realm of being one with the Lord, united with the Lord. United with the Lord. We are united with Him. We are one in flesh and bone, to the bone level. You can have that intimacy with God. You can have that. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Glory be to God. Look at Ephesians chapter 5 and verse 30.
For we are members of His body.
We are members of His body. We are members of His body. Verse 32 says we are flesh to flesh, bone to bone. We are together. So we have to cleave to God from the core. Can you just say, Lord, change my core. Change my core. Who I am. I don't want to be a surface believer. As I learn the golden altar of incense, I want my deep core to call for prayer. Deep call it to deep. Communion with God. Always. Oh, Rama Shadarada. Hallelujah. When you are in that level, you worship God. It's no more. It's, I would say, praying in the spirit. Praying in the spirit, you sometimes start with tongues and then you see visions. You see glorious things. You see glorious things of the word. You see what's happening around you. You see visions. You see dreams. That's what this is, the golden altar shows. It's not the surface level of prayer, but it's the core level of prayer where God shows you. God says in Jeremiah 33 verse 3, call unto me and I will answer you and show you great and mighty things which you have not seen or heard. So that is inner communion. It shows praying in the spirit, intercessory prayer, worship. You know you are in the presence of God and transformation of things are happening in this realm of prayer. You're becoming more like Jesus. You become more like Jesus. Your prayers become word-centric and not world-centric. Romans 12, 1 and 2. Let's pray as we stand between living and dead. Show transformation in character. So our core is transformed. See, somehow there are many people who pray without transformation of character. But these two things should go. Lord, transform my character to be made more like you. And when I pray in the spirit, that is what this incense prayer talks about. It will be a sweet smelling aroma in God's sight. Hallelujah. Romans 12, 1 and 2. Can we read it together? I will lead it. You can also take it. It's a beautiful verse. You all know it. But this is what the whole life of Christianity is all about. Therefore, I urge you, brothers and sisters, can we all read it together? In view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship. Do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, His good, pleasing, and perfect will. Amen. Praise the Lord. So in that realm, in the body of Christ, there should be unity. From 3 to 10, we will read it together. For by the grace given me, I say to every one of you, not think of yourself more. Can we read it together? Romans 12 and verse 3 onwards. By the grace given me, I say to every one of you, do not think of yourself more highly than you ought, but rather think of yourself with sober judgment, in accordance with the faith God has distributed to each of you. For just as each one of us has one body with many members, and these members do not all have the same function. So in Christ, that core of being in Christ. So in Christ, we though many form one body, and each member belongs to all the others. Each one of us belong to one another. We have different gifts according to the grace given to each of us. If your gift is prophesying, then prophesy in accordance with your faith. If it is serving, then serve. If it is teaching, then teach. If it is encouraged, then give encouragement. If it is giving, give generously. If it is to lead, do it diligently. If it is to show mercy, do it cheerfully. Cheerfully. Some people, what is the last verse? Means some people do not deserve your mercy, but love forgiving people. That's what it is. Love forgiving people. Not looking at what they are doing, but you do because you are in the golden altar of incense. You are touched by the golden incense. Your character, you know, many a time in our life, our character is determined on other person's reaction, correct? If he reacts, I will do this. If he is not good and react, that's not. Our character should be changed to the core of who we are. To the core of who we are. Our character should be changed to the whole core, that we will not be concerned about others, how they react or who they are, but our character is touched by Christ. Can we all say, may our character be touched by Christ? May our character be touched by Christ. Then, verse 9, love must be sincere, hate what is evil, cling to what is good, be devoted to one another in love. Be devoted to one another. See, friends, in these lockdown times, we willingly have tried to contact people. We have lost some people. In fact, lost means we do not have any contact with some of them. We tried reaching out to them. Some people asked, why are you calling? Some people in our church asked, why are you calling? This is a lockdown. Why do you want to call? This is why we are calling. Be devoted to one another in love. Why are we having a Zoom call? We are devoted to one another in love. It's not that others who do in YouTube are not devoted to one, but we find it together to encourage one another, to hear one another pray, to hear some people leading worship. We are still doing that virtual experience so that we are devoting to one another in love. Hallelujah. Honor one another above yourself. Never be lacking in zeal, but keep your spiritual fervor serving the Lord. Amen. Never lack in zeal, but keep your spiritual fervor. Be joyful in hope, patient in affliction. Now what we need to do is we should be patient till the vaccine comes or till the Lord delivers us. We have to be patient. Faithful in, I want all of you to say that. Faithful in. Somebody open your mouth and say, faithful in
prayer.
Faithful in prayer. You ought to pray for me. I ought to pray for you. Faithful in prayer. Faithful in prayer times. Faithful in times of prayer. Share with the Lord's people who are in need. Practice hospitality. Bless those who persecute. These are the incense. These are the character level changes which happens to a person of prayer. Once you give your life as a living sacrifice, this happens in the core. Character changes. Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse. Rejoice with those who rejoice. Mourn with those who mourn. Live in harmony with one another. Do not be proud, but willing to associate with people of low position. Do not be conceited. Do not repay anyone evil for evil. Be careful to do what is right in the eyes of everyone. If it is possible, as far as it depends on you, live at peace with everyone. Do not take revenge, my dear friends. But leave room for God's wrath, for it is written, it is mine to avenge, I will repay, says the Lord. On the contrary, if your enemy is hungry, feed him. If he is thirsty, give him something to drink. In doing this, you will heap burning coals on his head. Do not be overcome by evil. Means when you think there is only evil character around you, do not become evil in your core. But overcome evil with good. In your core, there is goodness. Because Christ's love has rubbed on our inner. Christ's prayer. Christ is the incense. Christ's likeness is our incense. With Christ's likeness, when we unite ourselves in prayer and pray, he will hear us. And that's the inner communion which we enjoy. We slowly, sometimes in worship, we do not wait for Sunday worship. Of course, that's a communal gathering where we understand that we are one in Christ, but alone in our homes. We say, Lord, I love you. I love you. I love you. My Lord, Lord, I love you. I love you. I love you, my Lord. Hallelujah. I'll serve you. I'll serve you. I'll serve you, my Lord. I'll serve you. I'll serve you. I'll serve you, our Lord. That's how it is. You in the holy place of prayer, everything else is secondary. But just the presence of God, life of Christ, life of prayer. You love prayer, you love being in the presence of God. And then there's the next level of prayer, which is with this you approach the presence of God, which is in the holiest, holy of holies. You take what happens in this realm, and there you're united with Christ. And many people say that will only happen when we see the Lord face to face. So you need to make this move into the temple. Make the temple move. Come to the altar, outer altar. Give your career. Let it be. Elevate the purpose of your career. Elevate the purpose of where you are. Elevate your community by prayer. And then move into the realms of the Spirit. As He talks to you, as He leads you. Transformation to the core. Being prayerful people to the core. Being character-oriented to the core. Loving God, cleaving to Him, united with Him. Praying always. And your prayers will make a difference. Hallelujah. What we see by faith, we will see by sight then. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah.